Good evening. I was not here to say it last week, so I'll say it tonight. Welcome back to Wednesday nights in the auditorium. Awana is going through its process of getting started up. There'll be kiddos in the Awana program in a week or two, and hopefully as we sing, like usually happens on Sunday morning, as we sing, we'll get a few people coming in to join us tonight. We're going to start with Wonderful Words of Life. Would you stand, please, and we'll sing tonight.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinner, list to the loving call, wonderful words of life. All so freely given, moving us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctify forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
Good evening. I have a pair of shoes on, and I didn't realize that these things are like walking on ice on this carpet. I'm afraid I'm going to slip and slide and embarrass myself. Got a couple of announcements for you. One, Dreama Haggard has been in the hospital. She went home today. Jessica Smith, which is Jane and Jerry's granddaughter, is back in the hospital, and she's at St. Joe's South, in her mid-30s, and her body is shutting down. The physicians say they don't think they can do anything for her anymore. She's got heart troubles and some other things. So Dreama and then Jessica Smith. We'll have a word of prayer in just a moment. During the summer months, or during these fall months, we're going to be having a rotation of preachers on Wednesday nights. I've got a list, and so between now and Thanksgiving, I've got five preachers in the church are going to be alternating. Our construction should start real soon. We're sending the commencement of work order in tomorrow morning first thing. So hopefully by next week, they'll be out here and starting. And I just know that I'm going to be back and forth a lot during this construction project because I get called all the time and going to try to relieve some pressure upon me until this construction project is through. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do ask that you bless Jessica. It's heartbreaking to hear of a woman this age whose body is just through. We pray you comfort her family as well. We're grateful that Dreama is home, and we pray, Lord, for her. We pray you strengthen her body, give her some resistance against disease. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Go ahead and have a seat. We've got a missionary tonight, and he's going to be on video. This is Joel Desour. He sent this about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and he looks like he's sitting in a lounge chair as he talks, a lounge chair in the front of the church. Go right ahead.
Folks, this is a Joel Desour missionary to Haiti. Today I'm here and New Testament Baptist Church. That's the church I start when I came to Haiti. I would like to give you an update for this month. This month, we see over 30 people receive Christ as their personal Savior. We see people baptized, we see life change. We see people saved in all the other churches we start. God bless our ministry. As a missionary, been in Haiti for 4 years. And 4 years, the Lord used me to start 3 churches. One is in Las Caobas, the other one in Bali, and one is in Sodo. And also, we have a national Bible conference where every year, several national pastors travel different cities to attend our Bible conference. And this auditorium, every year we have 600 people attend our Bible conference. We have a bus ministry to pick up people to bring to the church. And also, I have a Bible college to train national preachers to preach the gospel. Since I've been as a missionary in Haiti, we see thousands of people receive Christ as their personal Savior. It was a February 7th this year. I was kidnapped by the gangster. My mom also. I passed 12 days in the hand of the kidnapper. In the 12 days, they beat me with 2x4. After that, we paid $52,000 to get released. The Lord already gave that money back. After I get released, my mom come to me. He said, "Sondo, please leave Haiti. Don't come back." God's people, you know what I said to mom? I said, "Mom, I'm not going to leave. I'm not going to quit." You know why? You never know. Some gangster might be saved, become a pastor, become a missionary. What would be happen to those people who never received Christ as a personal Savior? What would be happen to them if I leave? I stay here to continue preaching the gospel, to start more churches, and to train more national preachers. God's people, I'm asking to be partner with me, to pray for me, where I can start more churches in Haiti.
Haiti is the poorest country in the Caribbean. It is located on the island of Hispaniola. It has 2 countries, Haiti and Dominican Republic. In 1804, Haiti became the first independent black country. The religion in Haiti is Voodooism and Catholicism. 80% of people in Haiti serve Voodoo. Because of the corrupt government, Haiti has become a very dangerous country. Brother Joel Desir was raised in a Voodoo family. His mother taught him Voodoo. When he was a boy, his desire was to become a Voodoo priest. But in 2004, God used a missionary to lead Brother Desir to Christ. Brother Desir is married to Lottie, and they have 2 girls. Brother Desir has been in Haiti for 4 years. In that time, he has started 3 churches, a bus ministry, and a Bible college to train nationals to preach the gospel. He also hosts a yearly national Bible conference. Please help Haiti to receive the gospel by partnering with Brother Joel to start more churches in Haiti.
Well, I remember when Joel Desir was here a few years ago, and him sitting still in a church pew and just speaking to the camera is not his normal character. That last shot at the end, where as he was translating for the other preacher, that's more of his character. He is a fireball of energy, and the Lord is doing a great work through him down in Haiti. So keep him in your prayers. Let's stand and sing again. We sang about the Word of God, wonderful words of life. We're going to keep singing about the Word of God. Open my eyes that I may see.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth you have for me. place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unlock and set me free. Silently now on bended knee, ready I wait, I will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my ears, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my heart, illumine me, Spirit divine.
Take a moment of fellowship. If there's somebody you haven't greeted tonight, reach out to them and tell them good evening. All right, we'll go ahead and take our seats again. And Pastor, it's a duet tonight. Pastor,
two voices,
and a euphonium. Baritone or euphonium?
Baritone.
It's a baritone. It's a very slight difference between a baritone and euphonium. You have to be an expert to know the difference.
Trained ear. Go ahead, Jim. When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds my hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great
thou art. How great thou art. It seems my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great. Of God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died. Take away my cost. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Going to be in Isaiah chapter number 1. During this preaching rotation, I'm going to speak four times. And I was going through some old stuff this week and found one sermon on Isaiah that said, good sermon never used. And I thought, well, I'm going to use it. Not tonight. I'm saving it for a little bit later, but I think it was a good sermon when I read it. I thought, that was a pretty good sermon. I wonder why I didn't use it. I have no recollection as why I would write a sermon and not use it. Isaiah chapter 1, easy to find. If you find Psalms, which is the biggest book, you keep going right. You'll go through Proverbs, Song of Solomon, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. And then Isaiah and Jeremiah are both major books. So if you get one of them, Isaiah is before Jeremiah. The book of Isaiah is a warning. The trump or the prophet is trumpeting out the repeated and habitual sins of God's people have pushed the long-suffering of God to its limit. book of Isaiah is the transcribed messages of one of the major prophets of the Old Testament. The book teaches more about Christ than any other Old Testament book. Some of Isaiah's favorite words are save and salvation. That makes sense because this book details the condition of people, and they were deep in sin, and there is no solution for sin other than the Savior and salvation through him. So we're going to read all 31 verses, and then what we're going to do, a little bit different, I'm going to put the verses on the screen as I go through the outline. I'm not going to read the verses during the outline. I'll let you read them. You can check, make sure that what I'm saying is correctly, but I'm going to read the whole text now and get the picture of it, and then for the sake of time, I'm going to go through the sermon quickly and let you do the reading. You can read and think at the same time. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amoz, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his crib's master, but Israel doth not know. My people doth not consider. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They are gone away backward. Why should ye be stricken any more? Ye will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot even to the head, there was no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. Your country is desolate, your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devoured in your presence, it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. And the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. Except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been as Sodom, and should have been like unto Gomorrah. Hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law, our God, ye people of Gomorrah. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, saith the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. When ye come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. Your new moons and your appointed feast, my soul hateth. They are trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you. Make you clean. Put away the evil doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. How is the faithful city become an harlot? It was full of judgment. Righteousness lodged in it, but now murderers. Thy silver has become dross, thy wine mixed with water. Thy princes are rebellious and companions of thieves. Everyone loveth gifts and followeth after rewards. They judge not the fatherless, neither do the cause of the widow come unto them. Therefore saith the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, ah, I will ease me of mine enemies and avenge me of my adversaries and avenge me of my enemies. And I will turn my hand upon thee and purely purge away thy dross and take away all thy tin. And I will restore thy judges as at the first and thy counselors as at the beginning. Afterward thou shalt be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city. Zion shall be redeemed with judgment, and her converts with righteousness.
and the destruction of the transgressors and of the sinners shall be together, and they that forsake the Lord shall be consumed. For they shall be ashamed of the oaks which ye have desired, and ye shall be confounded for the gardens that ye have chosen. For ye shall be as an oak whose leaf fadeth, and as a garden that hath no water, and the strong shall be as tow, as into towing something, and the maker of it as a spark, and they shall both burn together, and none shall quench them. Heavenly Father, help us now as we study your word. In Christ's name, amen. Years ago, I heard a preacher. His name was James Robinson. Probably in the 1980s, he was preaching revival stuff, and he was a really hot man at that time, preaching about the prophets. And I remember a statement that he made: no prophet of Israel who came to a city was ever invited back. Many of them were killed. They were hated. When a prophet came to town, there was trouble, because they never came to say, "You're doing a good job." They always came to tell you what was going wrong, and they were rough. The nice message is about Isaiah. It's the man and the message. And the man is mentioned in verse 1. His name means Jehovah's salvation. Isaiah's ministry began in 756 BC during King Uzziah's reign. And he reigned through Uzziah and Jotham and Ahaz and Hezekiah, four kings. Then Manasseh for a little short time. Tradition says he was sawn in two by order of Manasseh. It's thought that in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 13, when he speaks about those who were sawn in two, he's speaking of this man. The message is a description of what he saw in a vision from the Lord. Since the Lord's prophets have a very high accuracy rate, by the way, Deuteronomy chapter 18 says that if a prophet of the Lord is ever wrong, don't fear him. Because when you speak for the Lord and you speak the Lord's words, you are never wrong. It's not that Isaiah was perfect, it's that the Lord who was speaking through him was perfect. And so, since the Lord is doing the speaking and he's telling of the vision of the Lord, what Isaiah has to say is right on, dead right. Whenever a prophet speaks for the Lord, he will be always right. The problem is that the people of God have become a bunch of rebellious children. It's in verse 2 through 9. They're not rebellious children according to their standards. Their judgment says they're doing just fine. But they were very rebellious as far as God was concerned. They rebelled against him, against his word, and against his will. They're saying we're doing just fine. God says, not so much. Verse 2 is the human viewpoint. The nation was prospering financially, doing well physically, because of the blessings of God that had been given to them in the past, but they are now living in rebellion against the Lord. A rebel is one who would break a contract or refuse to do that which is expected of him. The covenant the nation of Israel has broken was the covenant that was given to them in Exodus 19 and 20. The covenant which the nation agreed to, the Ten Commandments are included in that covenant. They did not appreciate all that the Lord had done for him. They did not appreciate that they had some responsibilities to obey, and so they simply ignored him. What the people thought about themselves and what God the Father and the prophet thought about them was very different. The divine viewpoint is given to us in verse 3 through 9. They were suffering from illness and injury because they have forsaken the Lord, and their problems were both physical and spiritual. When I read Isaiah chapter 1, I cannot help but think about some things in the United States of America. The troubles that we're having. We are a country that was blessed of God, but we are turning from him very quickly. And it's happening so fast, I'm pretty certain that a lot of folks in church, believers, Christians, are not even aware of what's going on. They're voting for things that are the antithesis of the Word of God. I hope that someday soon we wake up. But right now we have a sleeping church and a nation that is turning against God and is rebelling against God in almost every way possible. These people had less devotion to God than animals do for their masters. If you look at verse 3 and 4, that's where I pick that up at. An ox knoweth its owner. The ass knows his master's crib. God's children had rejected their master, replaced the Lord with iniquity of a variety of sorts. Their sins were so great that the Lord described them as being laden with iniquity, burdened down with it. but unwilling to get rid of it. That's a picture of America right now. We're just getting loaded down with sin, but we don't seem to have any desire to get rid of it. Their sins were not just personal and private. Their sins affected others. Therefore, according to these verses, they are corruptors. They're not satisfied in sinning alone. They wanted to bring others along with them into sin. You know something strange? If you think about alcohol, someone who drinks alone is said to have an alcoholic problem. Someone who drinks around others, who gets others to drink with them, that's okay. No, it's not. Scripture says, woe unto him to give his brother strong drink. But our culture has flipped it around. I don't think you should drink alone. I don't think you should drink with others. I don't think you should get others to drink. I think it's, all of it is dangerous. So in verse 3 and 4, we have their devotion. It's the description of the spiritual. But verse 5 through 10 is the description of the physical problems. It's a vivid description of the Lord's view of the work of sin. And the sins of the Israelites were not occasional errors. They're habitual rebellions. They were being stricken because of their repeated revolting against the will of God for their lives. Verse 5, I think it says, why should ye be stricken anymore? Ye will revolt more and more. How many things have happened in our country where people get involved in deep sin and then some horrible disease comes their way and the disease is related to their sin? Did you know what the original label for AIDS was? It was GRID, gay-related immune disorder. You know why they changed it? Didn't want to hurt people's feelings. It's still related to the homosexual movement. But we want to soften things up as a country and as a culture. By not labeling things correctly, we're actually promoting sin. Right now, we have medical doctors who are promoting trans in children. It's a direct rebellion against God. God created you male or female. And if God created you male and you think God made a mistake, you're rebelling against God. And if an adult helps a child do that, I keep thinking of the scripture talks about hurting a child. You're better if a millstone were put on your neck and you're thrown in the ocean. I'm beginning, by the way, I used to just give doctors blank respect. I ask questions now. And I have some doctors, they give me sideways looks. But when the doctor comes in there and I'm in the room, I'm paying for this, I'm going to ask questions. I've had some arguments with doctors. Matter of fact, just about everyone come in, I ask, what do you do about COVID? What did you do? They all backed away. I asked questions. Did you ever study how large the COVID virus was? I've not found a doctor yet said yes. You know how small the COVID virus was? A human hair is 260 times larger than the COVID virus. It is microscopic. You know how large the hole is in a medical mask? Large enough for the coronavirus to fly right through unabated. Now, if you're wearing an N95 that's fitted, you're doing something and you are protecting yourself. But if you're just wearing a regular blue mask, you're just playing games. And the medical profession knows it, which is why when this whole thing came out, they said, don't buy the N95 masks, reserve those for the doctors. They should have said, we're going to protect the doctors, the rest of you are on your own. No, they wanted you to feel like they're doing something for you. They're making your life miserable. That's about all they did. By the way, it's coming back. I think I know why it's coming back. I could get thrown in jail for this because there's actually a guy who's been thrown in jail for believing this. I think the last election was cheated. I think there's a lot of cheating going on, and I think they used COVID as the cover for the cheat, and I think it's going to happen again. I think they're working at it right now. I can't drive through Georgia because if I drive through Georgia, they could slap me and put me in jail. It's now illegal in America to believe that election was stolen. We're losing our country. The citizens' condition is verse 5 and 6. The sins they were involved in had affected them mentally and emotionally and physically. Verse 5. Their thoughts were sick. The whole head is sick. Their heart is without courage or strength. The whole heart is faint. And the body was ill and injured from foot to head. These people were without soundness. It means that nothing was right from the sole of the foot even to the head. They were wounded. They were not just diseased. They were injured and bruised. Now, bruises are rough. They're a result of severe blows, sometimes blood poisoning. Bruises are painful. When the Lord looked at these people, he did not just see sick heads, sick hearts, sick bodies. He saw them as if they were themselves open sores, not covered, not medicated, and oozing forth infection. That's what God is describing his people as. The country's condition is in verse 7, 8, and 9. You see, sin not only affects the people of a nation spiritually, it also affects the physical conditions of a people in the nation too. Your country is desolate. Their sin affected their homes. Your cities are burned with fire. Their sin had affected their fields and their crops. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence, and it is desolate and overthrown by strangers. Did you know that having borders and having strangers coming in your country is a sign of the curse of God? We're there. We voted for it. Either a majority voted for it, or I'm right and they cheated. I don't like either one of those answers. The once populated nation looked like a ghost town. The daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. Had it not been for the grace of God, the very few who would still live there would have been destroyed too. Except the Lord of hosts had left a very small remnant, we should have been a Sodom. We should have been a Gomorrah. The people of God have become rebellious children. And their sin of rebellion has affected them in ways that they are unable to recognize. Have you seen the protests going on lately? Most every protest is accompanied by foul things. Using the F word and you screaming at people. Or like what took place back in June in New York City, where there was a gay parade and the chant was, "We're here, we're queer, and we're coming for your children." Honestly, if this had happened 50 years ago, there would have been vigilante stuff to stop this. We're so used to being tolerant and have been told to be tolerant. We're being tolerant of things that are intolerable. God's blessing has been removed from their lives. They're reaping the result of their sin. At the same time, they are in rebellion of sin and they're religious. And they are unaware that God's blessing has been removed. Verse 10 through 15 speaks about religious people. We could pass some pretty strong judgment against these folks from what the Word of God says, but I think we probably should be careful because America's not doing all that great. We've got a family attending church here on Sunday mornings. I think they're registering kids in Awana tonight. They're from Canada. The stories they tell about what's happened in their country are frightening. It took them 3 years to get out of Canada. 3 years to get it. There are preachers in Canada in jail right now for preaching the gospel. There are preachers in jail for saying homosexuality is a sin. It's happening now in Norway as well. Legislature there, lady. Years ago, like 1980s, she was a medical doctor, and she talked about the illness of homosexuality. They've arrested her and charged her with hate crimes. Josh tells me about things in England. I always thought that America and England were pretty close. No, not even close. When they went to England, guns are not allowed. None. So they started killing people with knives. So now you can't own a knife. You can't carry a knife. If you have a fixed blade knife, it can be 3 inches long. A folding blade knife cannot have a lock on it. You know why? Because when they took away guns, they started killing people with knives. So then they got to take away knives. In England, sidewalks right up against the house, Josh's house, about 4 or 5 feet from the street, and there's a sidewalk there, and they were specifically told, do not let your children play on the sidewalk in the front of your house. And Katie said, why? And they said, there are people who will run over children just for the fun of it. And so my grandkids are locked in the house because it's too dangerous to be on the street. Katie called this morning, Vicky, and said, it's 5 hours different there. She said, I'm feeling guilty. Vicky said, what are you feeling guilty? She said, I let the kids go to the park alone. How far is the park? Half mile. She said, I feel like that if someone sees my children there in the park alone, they will arrest me. Is it that bad? It's that bad. She said, I've never felt this kind of oppression anywhere in my life. Been there for 3 months, and she's now saying, thank God for America. My comment is, we may not be the same by the time you get back in 3 years. As fast as we're going down the slope, I hear politicians all the time say, we want to be like Canada. We want to be like England. We want to be like Europe. No, thank you. I want to be like America. I think the way things are going right now is it's not fine. It's a whole lot better than anywhere else, though. There's just not another place I would want to live. I don't know if you knew it or not. There is a Protestant church in America, one for about every 500 people. That doesn't count Catholic churches, Jewish temples, Muslim mosques, Mormon temples, or any other cult worship centers. But there's about one Protestant church for every 500 people. I wonder how many of those churches, Protestant churches, stopped preaching the gospel long ago. We've got a lot of religion going on, but the religion in America is no longer having a profound impact on society. Prisons are full. Nation's crime rate is skyrocketing. Divorce rate remains high, which is amazing, especially when you think how many people live together before they get married or before they split up. And if they live together for 3 years and then split up, it's not counted as a divorce. It is, but it's not counted as one. TV and movies seem unaffected by religious people. When's the last time you saw a movie where a church was presented in a positive light? I can't remember. Especially, I guess you could say, well, if you go back in time, you could go back and get something in the 1800s, you know. They might show a church in a good light. They all sing the same song, Bringing in the Sheaves. That's the only song they know. But even then, most of the time, the preacher is a fool or a scoundrel. Modern day religion has become entertainment. Very good at relationships. Very good at drawing a crowd. Very poor at teaching the Word of God. And as we go more and more into this, religion, even Christian denominations, are having less and less impact on the society. I don't know if you've noticed it, I have. There are a whole lot of Catholics who are stepping up and taking positions of leadership in our country. If you listen to Fox News, most of those presenters are Catholic. There are very few Protestants. I would rather have Catholics as no one, but there are very few Protestants. Why? Are we just not engaging in the culture? I think there's good reason to question the validity of the religion that's being practiced in America today. We're not having an impact on our culture. I question whether we're doing a good job raising our kids. We've had folks come to this church and tell us one of the reasons they came is because when they visited here, their children left the Sunday school and junior church and said, well, if we come back here, we have to bring a Bible. And mom said, well, you don't have to bring a Bible in your church? No, no. Well, no. And the little girl said, no, they teach the Bible here, Mom. And my mom said, well, what do they teach? What do you do in Sunday school at our church? And the girl said, we play Connect Four. She said, you don't ever get... She said, no, we've never been taught the Bible at our church. It's an evangelical church. Real near, real close to here. If you can't count on churches to be teaching God's word is not going to be taught. Their sacrifices are mentioned in verse 10 and 11. The number of religious meetings and the number of sacrifices were described by the Lord as multitude. But since the sacrifices were not backed up with sincerity, the Lord saw no significance in them. And the Lord rejected their religious activity because it was a religion of sham and hypocrisy. And their sins are mentioned in verse 12 and verse 15. The very number of sins made their prayers and their coming before the Lord a sham. I used to have friends that would go out Friday night, drink all they wanted to, go on Saturday night to confession. By Sunday morning, everything's good. That was their routine every week. Do everything you want on Saturday night. Just make sure to confess. Excuse me, on Friday night, just make sure to confess on Saturday, and you all got a clean slate. You think the Lord didn't figure that out? We sometimes act like God is asleep. God is not impressed with the volume of our religious service if we come before him with sin unforgiven. And the sins of the people in Isaiah 1 are listed as, like verse 21, murder. Faithful city is a harlot, full of judgment, righteous lodge in it. Now they're murderers. It was full of goodness, and now it's full of evil. Robbery, bribery, exploitation is mentioned in verse 23. The sin of the nation was a top-down phenomena, and it began with the princes. A prince will have influence and opportunity for evil activity more than a common man can imagine. A prince, a ruler, needs to be of the highest character. Now, just have some fun. Neither of our last two presidents had very high character, now have they? Just popped the Democrats and the Republicans in the face, both. Donald Trump was anything but a man of character. Joe Biden is corrupt as he can be and has been for decades, and it has been known for decades, and he was put up for president for one reason and one reason only. He could beat Donald Trump. So we had two choices. Both of them were a prince without character. I still voted for one. I'd vote for him again in the same situation. I think I voted for the lesser of two evils because in the whole voting thing, I don't vote for a personality. I vote for a principle, and the principles are based upon what the political party's platform is. So I vote for the principle, not for the character. I could care less that the president has charisma. I care that he has character. When leaders of a nation are involved in iniquity, the common man will follow, will justify himself in his sin, because the lives of the leaders justify it. Years ago, when Bill Clinton was president, I heard a man who had been one of his friends, and they were discussing, how is it that Bill Clinton is so popular, thinking of all the things that Bill Clinton has done? And the guy said, easy. Bill Clinton makes Joe Sixpack feel good about himself, because Bill Clinton is worse than Joe Sixpack. That was Bill Clinton's friend. I believe it was that fellow from Louisiana. I can't recall his name, but he married a conservative woman and they fought on television, which was a great way to have a great marriage, which didn't last. Their leaders had become companions of thieves. And a companion of a thief will act like his friends. We either act like our friends or make excuses for our friends or reject them. My mother used to say all the time, I don't need to know what you do. I just need to know what your friends do. I said, that's not fair. And she'd say, birds of a feather. Never finished the sentence. I knew exactly what she's going to say. She didn't have to finish it. She's exactly right. We do what our friends do. To love gifts And to follow after rewards is the equivalent of hating work while seeking monetary gain at every opportunity, and that is corruption. You get money for nothing or money for influence. I believe our current president, they're saying anywhere, but they know of $20 million. They think about like $37 million of bribes been given to him by China, Russia, Ukraine, and one other, and I can't recall which. And half of Americans will vote for him again. I think we're in at least the same shape as Israel was. Things are getting pretty bad. These people did not care about others. And if they did, they wouldn't lift a finger to help anyone unless it would be a benefit to them. Verse 29 mentions idolatry, another sin. The sin of idolatry is one of the worst of all sins. It's an insult to the Creator and to the character of God. Idolatry is when man creates a god in his own image or in something he imagines. Man sets all the standards, makes all the rules. One of the things that Israel used to do was they would worship idols in groves of trees. Some of them were cedars, some of them were oak. Some of the pieces of the trees would be taken and carved into special shapes to worship as an idol. The gardens were considered to be special holy places that were reserved for the worship of the idols. Some speculate that the things that went on there were shameful enough that they wanted to have the cover of the trees so they weren't in open public. But if you sin long enough, before too long, people don't care. In verse 13 and 14, their assemblies are mentioned. They attended religious services. They observed the Sabbath. They even observed the special Jewish holy days, the solemn meetings. And the Lord is not impressed with their religious activity. He even ordered them to stop practicing their religion. Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination to me. Your new moons and your appointed feasts my soul hates. They are troubling to me. I am weary to bear them. The Lord went so far as to say that their religious observances were sin. It is iniquity. Even the solemn meeting. Wow. People go to church, and at church, sin is practiced. Well, there's a prescription. It's verse 16 through 31. Isaiah is kind of playing the role of a mediator between God Almighty and the nation of Israel. It doesn't seem like one. It seems like he's taking sides. I think he's taking sides. He's on God's side. Good place to be. But he's still caring about his people. He's still reaching out to them. The Lord is using Isaiah to shake these people. The judgment is about to be announced. But first, God has authorized Isaiah to offer a plea bargain. It's an offer that ought to be considered too good to pass by. In verse 18, the reason being called for is reasoning as in making a judgment. Let us reason together. Let's think. And the crimes are murder, robbery, bribery, exploitation, idolatry. The option for the people are clear. There would be repentance and redemption or justice and judgment. And they got to make a choice pretty quick. Repentance is ordered in verse 16 and 17. When sins are truly forgiven, there is a cleansing. Wash you, make you clean. Change of mind. Put away the evil doings from before mine eyes. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. There's also a change of activity with repentance. There's a positive and negative command here. Cease to do evil. Relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Repentance always involves a change of behavior. And by the way, repentance is something that every believer who gets in sin needs to practice. You need to change yourself by repenting of sin. Redemption is offered in verse 18. Before they were to make the decision, Isaiah called on them to be reasonable. Scarlet was considered to be the fastest of all colors, meaning the strongest dye. It neither rain nor washing it or even using it would make the scarlet garment fade. And so it was one of the choice colors of fabric. The reasoning of Isaiah is profound. If your sin is as scarlet, there's no remedy for your sin. You cannot wash it out. You cannot wear it out. So if there's no remedy for your garment of scarlet, there's no remedy for you a sinner in sin. Nothing you can do. There's no ritual. There's no righteousness. There's no work. There's no frequency of sacrifice. No matter how many tears, how often your prayers, nothing is going to remove your sins, which are as scarlet, other than God himself. Retribution is optioned in verse 19 and 20. The prophet offers two options. Take the plea bargain, admit your guilt, repent of your sin, receive redemption, or receive the judgment of the Lord in retribution for your sins. Your sins are what you have already committed. An additional sin, the rejecting of God, is not what you needed. In verse 21 through 23, the ruin of these people is obvious. I'm going to give you just a moment to read it if you wish, and then I'll close. In verse 24 through 31, righteousness is offered. Going to be one text there, and then there's going to be two slides with the text to read it. God is offering to wipe their record clean in response to their faith, even though he has every reason to punish these people for their sin. His grace and mercy is what he uses as motivation to offer forgiveness of sin. God even went so far as to describe the judgment that would be theirs if they remained as his enemies and refused to repent. You know, the Lord does not leave us in sinful condition. He offers relief for our sins through the sacrifice of his Son. The only way to get rid of your sins, which are as scarlet, is to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. And in some miraculous way, the Lord pictures that your sins are as scarlet, and the blood comes and will soak into that garment, and it dries as white as snow. Well, that's a miracle. Amen to that. When you think about the salvation of your soul, I know that technically salvation is not a miracle. It's part of the plan of God. But I really like what that songwriter wrote. But when he saved my soul, he cleansed and made me whole. It was a miracle of love and grace. The fact that God saved me. That's really the only miracle I need in my life. If I get no miracle, I've got that one. That one's good enough. Heavenly Father, what a brave man Isaiah was. Walk into town, confront people, doing his very best to tell him what the vision he saw from the Lord was. There's no doubt by the time he finished this chapter, there were people angry at him, glaring at him, wondering what they could do to make him shut up and go away. Thank you for this man's boldness, for his willing to suffer for the sake of righteousness. Help us to share that. Help us to be bold. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.